Good afternoon, Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and Google Plus. This is Rich again, back for your second video blog of the day for Tuesday, April 26, 2016, around 4:42 in the afternoon, Berwick, Massachusetts. Cloudy out right now, a lot of rain today, very, very damp, only about 45 degrees. Tonight's going to be clear but chilly, frosty, frost advisory, so if you started the plants, bring them in. And tomorrow's supposed to be nice in the 50s, but no 70s or 80s until maybe later on next week. Some news to report. The Oakland Raiders are one step closer to moving to Las Vegas, Nevada. Also, former NFL quarterback Jamarcus Russell was the number one pick in the 2007 NFL draft, says he would love to return to the National Football League. He would play for free if he wanted to order to play again. But he will never play in the NFL again, and he's not going to be working for the NFL for free because the NFL's not charity. And it's happy National Pretzel Day. Florida Panthers captain Willie Mitchell is going to retire because he's been injured. And Steve Kerr of the Golden State Warriors has won NBA Coach of the Year. And that's about it on news. My second video blog subject of the day is the start of a four-part series on WWE errors. The first video blog I'm talking about is WWE Error from 1984 through 1993, the Federation years. The WWE was a regional territory in the northeast part of the United States, run by Vince McMahon Sr., and he usually from Bangor, Maine, all the way to Washington, D.C., and it was a successful regional promotion for many, many years, and it was probably the number one regional promotion in the United States because they had the big markets, New York, Philadelphia, Washington, Boston, etc., etc. And in 1983, Vince McMahon Jr. Expanded the WWE from a Northeast promotion throughout the United States, going into first California and then other areas of the country. He had the USA Network. He was on TBS for a while, and he gobbled up regional promotions, and he took their big stars. The biggest star for the WWE during this time period was Hulk Hogan. Hulk Hogan defeated the Iron Sheik for the WWE Championship at Madison Square Garden on January 23rd, 1984, and held the title for 4 years, his first title reign, and he had four more successful title reigns after that during the Federation years. And Hulk Hogan brought mainstream publicity to professional wrestling, and Vince signed other top regional stars like Rowdy Piper, Paul, Mr. Wonderful, Orndorff, Big John Studd, Bobby the Brain Heenan, King Kong Bundy, Greg the Hammer Valentine, Ricky the Dragon Steamboat, The Mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart, and so many others, Terry Funk, Dory Funk Jr., the Junkyard Dog, Hampson Holly Race, who became King Holly Race. Soon, Vince McMahon was syndicating championship wrestling and all-star wrestling all across the country. Many of these television stations originally showed regional wrestling promotions like Championship Wrestling for Florida, Georgia Championship Wrestling, AWA, Mid-Atlantic, World Class Championship Wrestling, and others, but these television stations got big bucks to drop their local wrestling organization to show WWE programming. Plus, WWE was securing house shows throughout the country in a lot of major arenas, but the time about to travel for the WWE at this time period during the early expansion of the WWE during the Federation years. They were crisscrossing the country, maybe going to three towns a night with three separate crews. One night they could be in Baltimore, Maryland, the next night Portland, Oregon, another night Miami, Florida, another night Chicago, Illinois, Boston, or Seattle, Washington. This was a crazy travel schedule for a few years, but with like the WWE expanding, the arenas had to give the WWE just a specific date, and they had to take it for expanding and stuff. And WWE became popular in merchandising with T-shirts, dolls, books, Saturday morning cartoons, etc., etc. But the biggest creation of the WWE during the Federation years is WrestleMania. WrestleMania started the first one on March 31st, 1985 at Madison Square Garden. This was not on pay-per-view at first because there was not too much pay-per-view capability. They had Madison Square Garden plus closed circuit throughout the United States at arenas, high school auditoriums, theaters, field houses, etc., etc. And this was a big calculated risk for the WWE and Vince McMahon. If WrestleMania did not succeed, then the WWE and Vince McMahon be out of business. They got celebrities at WrestleMania, and the main event was Hulk Hogan and Mr. T facing off against Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff and Rowdy Rowdy Piper. It was a great main event, and WrestleMania 1 broke even at 3 o'clock the next morning when they were counting all the receipts for all the closed circuit locations. Vince McMahon and Linda McMahon had to take out a line of credit because they were afraid that WrestleMania was going to be a money losing proposition for them, but it didn't, and the WWE was off and running. They started having pay-per-views. WrestleMania was a pay-per-view staple, and then they added other pay-per-views, including Survivor Series, SummerSlam, and the Royal Rumble. And WWE television programming was on the USA Network, All-American Wrestling, TNT, which was Tuesday Night Titans, and Primetime Wrestling, highly rated cable shows. Plus the syndicated programs were All-Star Wrestling and Championship Wrestling, which they filmed in Poughkeepsie, New York for Championship Wrestling, and All-Star Wrestling in London, Ontario, Canada. And WWE's announcers at this time were Vince McMahon and Bruno Sammartino. The A team and the B team was Gorilla Monsoon and Jesse the Body Ventura. And the Federation was continuing to gain steam. And it was the recognized leader in the world of sports entertainment. 1986 September, the syndicated programs were rebranded. Championship Wrestling was rebranded as Superstars of Wrestling. Vince McMahon and Bruno Sammartino and Jesse Ventura handled that, and they taped it in arenas across the country instead of Poughkeepsie, New York, Mid-Hudson, Pacific Center. And they taped Wrestling Challenge at arenas as well. It was hosted by Gorilla Monsoon and Bobby the Brain Heenan, which was a comedy team. And also Wrestling Spotlight, it was review of WWE shows, and the WWE expanded worldwide into taking tours of Europe and getting real successful. Hulk Hogan was the biggest cash cow for the WWE during the Federation years. Macho Man Randy Savage and the Ultimate Warrior and Jake the Snake Roberts, the Million Dollar Man, Ted DiBiase, Hacksaw Jim Duggan, whole tag teams like the Hart Foundation, the Rockers, the Bushwhackers, whoa, yeah, Demolition, and so many others. But there was a lot of gimmicks in the WWE as well. Some of them were okay, but other ones were cartoonish, because this was like the cartoonish era, as well as the Federation years, because Saturday morning cartoons were real popular during the 1980s. That was the peak of Saturday morning cartoons. There was a Saturday morning cartoon, Hulk Hogan's Rock and Wrestling Connection, on CBS for 2 years. But all the wrestlers' voices were done by actors instead of the real wrestlers, because they were afraid that they wanted more money. And the WWE was continuing to grow in popularity into 1989 and stuff. That's when they had to admit to New Jersey that wrestling was predetermined, so they could avoid taxes and drug testing. And this is also around a time where there was steroids became illegal, and many of WWE superstars used steroids. And there was also former superstars for WWE, including superstar Billy Graham, Dr. D, David Schultz, and Bruno Sammartino, saying that wrestling was running rampant. And the popularity of the WWE during the Federation years was going down. 1990, 1991, and 1992 was a downward period. Hulkamania was losing steam. It gave him the titles many times, like four other times, but it wasn't as successful. Hulk Hogan went to do movies. They tried to groom his success as the Ultimate Warrior, but he flopped as champion. They had to put it back on Hogan. They had the Intercontinental title, several champions, including Tito Santana, Greg the Hammer Valentine, Randy Macho Man Savage, Ricky the Dragon Steamboat, the Honky Tonk Man, the Ultimate Warrior, Ravishing Rick Rude, Mr. Perfect, the Texas Tornado, Bret the Hitman Hart, Rowdy Piper, British Bulldog, and Shawn Michaels were the ones who held it during the Federation years. And in the Federation years, by like 1991, 1992, was a very shell of its former self. They tried to groom more stars, but some of them didn't pan out. They brought Sid into the WWE. It was called Sid Vicious, but he was Sid Justice. But he left after maybe 8 months, after he flunked a drug test. Also, they started having more cartoonish gimmicks, like Papa Shango, Skinner, Nails to feel with the Big Boss Man, and so many others. But during the latter half of the Federation years, they created one of the biggest stars in WWE history, The Undertaker, who made his debut at Survivor Series 1990. He's still wrestling today, on and off. And it was the WWE product was stale by 1993. And that's when they went with a new generation, which was a few years. And also, this is when the time towards the end of the Federation years and start of the Attitude Era, that the WWE was in hot water with the government. The FBI, Vince McMahon, was indicted in 1993, but he wasn't convicted. And the Federation years, in my humble opinion, for the WWE was the best era in professional wrestling, in my humble opinion, because this is when wrestling went mainstream from regional territories straight to worldwide. And the icon is Hulk Hogan of wrestling, and it's also the icon is Vince McMahon. Millions and millions of dollars were made during the Federation years, and most of the well-known wrestlers went to the WWE during this time period. And this was when wrestling was wrestling, professional wrestling. This was the best of times for pro wrestling, like old school. I enjoy watching these on YouTube and stuff. And the Federation years are the best for the WWE. Wish we could go back to them, but it's not going to happen. Tomorrow I'm going to be talking about the WWE's new generation, which lasted from 1993 through 1996. And I'll be back with the third and final video blog of the night, which will be about former GSN program, GSN Live. Keep calm, everybody. I'm a Julie Button guy. Molly Rosenblatt of WCCO has nice legs. Elizabeth Atso, so stunning. She's the best. Amy Swansea, so awesome. Julie Gower, Fox 25, Fox. Kelly Nash of MLB Network and NHL Network. Locks and Jamie Hirsch of MLB Network and NHL Network is so cool, and she has nice legs. And in the words of Sean Lucha, get out! Bye now!